You're Near the Wild with Matt Becker and John Norris, recorded in Anchorage, Alaska.
I hear some scurrying.
Hello?
Hey, Matt.
Hi.
How are you?
I am fantastic.
Do you want to continue to hook up whatever you were hooking up there?
I was trying to get the microphone thing figured out there. I might, one second. There we go. Perfect. How's that sound?
Tinny, what's up?
Tinny?
Yeah.
We could try it without. Should I just do it through the iPad?
What are you going through right now? It's not the regular microphone, is it?
No, it's a headset.
Oh, okay.
I thought it would work better.
Try it without, just real quick.
How about now?
Oh, that sounds better.
Okay.
Well, it's a little boomier just because it's got the doing the whole room. Right? It's just like putting someone on speaker, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that should be fine.
It's because I had such a big room.
Yeah. No, did you get the upgrade?
Yeah. Yeah, they gave me the super sweet. But Rami had the best. Rami, you know, we run pretty wild, and Rami got a bang at his door at 8 a.m. He's like, and he's asleep with the door lock on. And he's in one of the suites too. And they're banging on the door, and they open it, they're banging, and he finally gets up. He's like, he's disoriented. He just got to bed. He's like, what the fuck? And it's maintenance guys go, open your fucking door. Open your fucking door. And he's like, open, who the fuck are you? And so he opens the door. There was a leak in one of the rooms. Somebody fucked up the tub, and it was run all the way down to the cage downstairs. Water was leaked, dripping on him.
Oh, my God. No one said anything until it hit the fucking casino floor.
Yeah. And it was, yeah. And it was on their computers and everything. He goes, we got to get this shut off. And it just happened. They gave him the sweet with the shut off valve in it.
Yeah.
So he's fucking standing there. And he goes, they're in there banging on this bike. Bam, bam. He's like, are you fucking kidding me? And for that, they took off half his resort fee.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. He wasn't going to do anything. I go, fuck that.
Well, yeah, you got to push back on something, right?
No, I mean, you know, why are you charging a resort fee anyway? What were you going to do if you didn't have a resort?
What's a resort fee? Is that kind of like paying for the undercoating on a car?
Exactly, yeah. They forever remember the Harris. They said, we won't do the resort fee. We don't agree with it. And then all of a sudden, we're doing resort fees. Yeah, I know. You know, like even when they comp, like the room for me, I mean, it's a great room and everything. But then, they stick it. It's $50 a day. But now they've added Wi-Fi. That's what makes all this possible.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Which so you're in Vegas.
Yes.
You're down there for the poker tournament?
World Series of poker. And then we've been hitting tournaments and doing pretty good.
And what, I mean, how many hours a day are you playing poker?
What we'll usually do is like this morning I get up, I'll go down, do the early bird, and we'll get done with that. Then we'll grab something to eat. Then everybody will break off and go run around. And then we will usually plan, like tonight we go to Batista's and we'll hit the poker tables again at about 11.
What's Batista's?
That's that restaurant, that Italian restaurant that's been there since the 1960s.
Is it like an old house?
Yeah, well, yeah. I mean, no, it's like an old bar, but it's like the old 50s style. I mean, literally everybody went there and it's right behind the Flamingo. It's right next to the stage door.
Okay.
Yeah.
A cheap place to drink.
Yeah. Yeah, we went there again. We're still always amazed when we do that. We have 7 people and we're like, yeah, get them all shots, get them all beers, give them everything. The lady's like $23. And we're like, are you fucking kidding me? Robbie's like, I have it. Gives her 40, keep it. And she was the owner. She goes, because they were really busy. For whatever reason, this weekend's been just slammed down here.
What is it?
Or this weekday, I mean. Yeah, it's Veterans Day, but.
Yeah, but that's not really, I mean, that's a recognized holiday, I think, as a bank holiday, right?
I think they discounted tickets all across the country. Remember, because they were going to do a federal investigation to see if they were
gouging. And since you said that, I've noticed that the prices have been unusually low. Even during Thanksgiving, because that's what we're getting ready to go on the 22nd. We're flying up to Seattle, and I was surprised. I mean, whatever. I know fuel costs are down too.
Yeah.
And they're still making a shit ton.
Fuel tax. They still charge you a fuel tax.
Well,
remember they said, "How are you still doing this?" And it was on one of those business shows, and they go, "Well, we started using it for other things." You go, "Oh, well, that doesn't seem like a ripoff."
You know, the thing that keeps popping up every couple of weeks, something comes up about baggage, taking bags, carry-on bags onto planes. And in some countries, they've got airlines that they're not allowed to bring anything other than a backpack and a purse. And then it's not really the rule. It's enforcing the rule, because they have rules like that in America, but no one gives a fuck, because the person that is like the first point of contact is the gate agent. And they see you put down the luggage that you're checking, and then they see these other two big, enormous bags, and they don't say shit. Cause they don't want to get yelled at, or they don't want to fucking deal with it. So they let the next person to have to deal with it. Well, it barely fits through the fucking scanner through TSA. No one says anything. Hey, that's a little big. I don't know if you're going to get that on the plane. No one says a fucking thing. Then they get there, and then they've got the fucking, someone built these little, point of sale end cap, displays of, does your bag fit in here? I mean, we've all seen people walk right by it and then, you know, hand their ticket or show their phone and go on the plane without anyone saying, "Hey, yeah, hold on a second. Hold up, Captain. Let's see if that fits in the bag."
I wondered if they still had that, because I couldn't see one when we were boarding in Seattle, and I realized the guy's bag was covering it up.
Yeah.
So I couldn't see behind it.
So so there were three or four points of contact where they could have nipped it in the bud early on. And you know, it's going to be uncomfortable for 6 to 8 months, but then everyone's going to fucking deal with it. And everyone's going to fucking realize that it's better, but no one does anything. So what happens? It goes to the lady on the plane, the one who's going to be stuck in there with that fucking asshole, you know, darting eyes and fucking mean mugging look, because you had to check your bag, you know, walking up the stairwell. You know?
Well, see, now the new scam, Greg, is that you bring your bag you would have checked and they want to charge you a fee. You bring it on the plane and then they check it for free if you're willing to give it up.
No, at the last minute. And they say, you know, we're real tight on space. If you want to check your bag, and I get it. And I think that's great that people want to do that. But the statistic that I read was that 70% of the flights would take off on time if we got rid of those extra bags.
Yeah.
I mean, go ahead.
Well, they wanted to charge you for any carry-on. There was a Canadian one that did that.
Yeah.
They said, "We're going to charge you if you bring any carry-on." But at the same time, remember the way the federal law is written, and if you don't have any checked bags, you're on a watch list. So
yeah.
Don't bring bags, you're a terrorist. And if you bring bags, you're a jackass. I don't understand.
You can't win. I just am still amazed. I mean, I think we've talked about it before. I mean, it's really, air travel used to be an event. And now, like communion or quinceañera or something, you know, you'd get dressed up and you'd go. Now it's really basically like going to a bus station, which, I mean, if you've been in a bus station lately, you realize that that's really a big building as a time machine taking you back to, and even the train stations are places where people who can't afford to be on a list or can't afford to have the government check their ID, that's where they go. There's no ID to get on a fucking train.
No, I know. And that's always the thing. And that's why I feel bad for people who have a fear of flying. You're stuck with the other people.
Yeah, it's something scarier.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd get over my fear of flying if I had to sit next to Gus.
Well, I love traveling on the train. And we did it overnight from LA Union Station to Bisbee, which you can't get all the way to Bisbee. There's no spur that comes down here anymore. But you get dropped off in Benson, this little town of Benson, and you literally get dropped off on a platform. There's no buildings. There's a
like in Planes, Trains, and Automobiles.
Exactly.
Bye.
And I remember it was an overnight, and it was really handled poorly at the at boarding in LA because they were holding the doors shut for some reason up until the last moment. And I think if I traveled more, I'd realize what was going on, but I was like kind of nervous of like, are we standing in the right spot? Is this cabin? Is this our cabin? No, and no one's relaying information. And, you know, you see the clock ticking and then we get on and finally someone opens the door and you're getting more information from other passengers more than from conductors or anyone who's working with Amtrak.
They teach you the ropes like,
yeah. Watch this. Yeah. Always keep your toothbrush with you. So what ended up happening was we were, it was overnight and at about 4 a.m, someone in the car we were in yelled, fucking who shit their pants. And this wasn't like, this was a guy who fucking was like fed up and yelled it. But like, even that was like, you're scarier than anyone who might be like blowing mud or maybe did shit their pants. You have no decorum whatsoever. You've now taken this to a level that is upsetting to small children and women, what you're doing here. And then I'm looking around like, all right, now there'll be someone up here to tell him to quiet down. Nope. That was it.
Yeah.
You know, and he fucking ends up stomping off and, you know, I mean, everyone like roots in and gets very fucking comfortable really quick on a train that, come on, it's not very clean. What are you walking around barefoot or like with your socks on? Even worse in this fucking cattle car, you know?
Yeah, because when you book the ticket, you're thinking of like the, what was that, Wild West where you're wearing a bolo tie.
Or the romantic era, you know? Yeah. We're going to Chicago, you know?
We're going to have some champagne.
We're going to see we're going to see America as it really is. Yeah. Really? Through a fucking smudgy window with fucking some guy shit his pants and another guy screaming at it and you're scared of both of them.
Yeah. Is it assigned seats or it's festival seating?
It's festival seating, man. Yeah, and you'd think that the Who was playing in there by the way people stampede to get in this little fucking door it basically looks like a fucking, like some kind of torture chamber, you know? You're going in and you know what? It'd be a really good haunted house. Would be an old train car. Because you got these little passages you go down, and you have little boo holes where you can slide a door open. Bah!
That's perfect. We got to do that next time. We'll just make it. We'll just put everybody on the train.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's like, excuse me, conductor, my seat. There's a burn barrel in my seat.
Yeah, but I think someone was saying that I mean, we're pretty close to the border here in Bisbee, and there's a lot of people who were associated with the drug trade or know stories about the drug trade. And they were saying that, oh, yeah, the train, that's the way that you can transport drugs. Because, I mean, on the off chance that they have a drug dog.
Well, at least to Benson.
Yeah, at least to Benson. So.
Yeah. I still think drones are going to make the drug trade huge.
I didn't even think of that.
First thing I thought of.
Yeah, I don't know what's a range on a drone. I mean, not a military drone. I mean, we know those are those are all linked up to some after school program in Simi Valley, California, where they're teaching these whiz kids on the game consoles to shoot down enemy combatants, but. Yeah. That's different than what I'm thinking of, like the ones you see the footage and stuff.
Right. These are those 6-foot ones that can carry a child.
Yeah. So like how far can you be on another mountain and be able to control it with your binocular eyeglasses or something?
Yeah. Cause they have, you know, the military grade GPS in them. So you can just basically, you sit there and I could fly it from here and I could be in, I mean, they fly them from the United States over in Afghanistan.
Yeah.
I mean, they're just a grid set up and they just use the coordinates.
I mean, it is very, it's fascinating and I think it's amazing, but, you know, this, we're getting to, what show was that? We're getting to this situation to where there's really, it's going to be robots against robots.
And yeah, we're not even going to be part of it.
I think there was I think it was, Bob Denver and another guy. Maybe it was Jim Nabors and Ruth Buzzy. They had a Sid and Marty Krofft show. It might have been Far Out Space Nuts. Anyway, both of those duos had one. And I remember the one where they were on an island. They were at a place. They were on a planet where the people had become so slovenly because they had robots doing everything. And they even had robots playing tennis to where you would just lay down on a lounger and, these robots would play. And then you would boast and you would fucking give the other person shit because your robot beat them. And, really, I mean, we're basically getting there just with killing machines.
That's great. I mean, Robot Wars. I mean, remember when they were doing that?
Yeah,
that
was,
they said they got a new version coming out and they're going to be higher tech. But
like the ones where you like simulate
BattleBots. Yeah.
BattleBots. Right? Yeah.
That was Bill Dwyer was the host of that.
Oh yeah, that's right. That was it. It was him and another guy. Basically, it was UFC for like four-wheeled bots. It was the ones with like they would put a fucking revolving circular saw on it or a thing that would hammer down when it got close to something. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah. And yeah. That was the thing with the hammer and bam, 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 jackhammer. And it was funny because the ones you thought, you go, oh, that's pretty good. Then the other one that was just had sticky stuff all over it had to kicking the shit out of them.
Didn't see that coming.
Reverse post-it notes. You go, damn it. Kid's like, I knew it.
So how did your Pauly Shore event go at Coots?
It was fantastic. Sold out both shows. He did wonderful. His opener was great.
Did he bring an opener?
Yeah, he brought a guy in. I don't have his card. I left it at home, so I didn't forget it. But yeah, we're gonna bring him back up too because he was really funny.
So what? Did he do like an hour of comedy?
Yeah, he did an hour 12. Pauly did both nights or both shows. It was same night, but yeah. He did his time and he was relaxed and it was exactly the show you expect. You know, I mean, he talked about the old days and the new days and everybody loved it.
Did he talk about the first time he came up to Anchorage? I hear John Norris now.
I thought that was his dog.
we both cough. I think I caught her cough.
We were just talking about Pauly Shore's visit to Chilkoot Charlie's in Anchorage last week.
I heard it was successful.
You didn't go.
I it was sold out.
Oh, okay.
I waited. I slept on the weasel and I had no idea. But the Kyle Farrell and Cass, I think both opened for him, or at least Kyle Farrell opened for him and said it was great. Yeah. The crowd was awesome.
I think Kyle had a picture posted. Yeah.
Pauly Shore, looking rough. Still very funny, I guess so.
Yeah. Well, the time. I'm not here. Father Time does not slow down for anyone, John.
I'm not here to shit on Pauly Shore, guys. I'm just saying. He didn't look his best. Maybe it was the lighting.
No, he, you know what was amazing? He had that ability, like George Burns, where when he went on stage, he bam, was right in the rhythm, perfect timing. Everything was great. But I'll tell you, going up on stage, I talked to him in the birdhouse before he went up, and I was like, I hope this goes well.
Yeah.
And that was the first show. Yeah, he did good.
So what were you concerned with? Do you think it was heckling or?
No, I thought he was stoned out of his mind. He could barely make sense. He goes, man, don't touch the weasel, man. Don't touch the weasel. He's telling some girl not to touch him. And I was like, that's cool. And, he's like, I'm on pain pills from my back. I got back. And then I was like, you got one eye open. And, but you know, I went and I popped in to see it. And he, like I said, they said it was a little rough start. And then he just got in character and he did it for both shows. And they were both great shows. Like I said, I get the rebuttal afterwards. I go, speak freely. Do you like it? They went, it was a blast. Thanks. Yeah.
Well, I mean, this is not to be sound offensive. I hope it doesn't sound offensive. Anchorage people are kind of easily impressed with B, C, D celebrities.
I think they appreciate it.
You know what? You're right.
Aren't you in Bisbee with a former boxer?
I put B in there. I should have just said C/D celebrities.
Listen, we would lose. You just never seen us lose our shit over an A-lister.
I guess not.
If an A-lister came up here, there'd be a riot in the streets.
Fucking, your heads would explode.
How's Jake LaMotta doing?
I just saw him 2 weeks ago. We went to the Stock Exchange, which is it is a bar that has the old Stock Exchange, old style, written in chalk exchange. There was an actual exchange out here when this was a boom town in the 1800s.
Yeah, and it's still the writing up there.
Yeah, yeah, you could see like different like GE or whatever. I don't fucking what they had back then, but you can see like old company names with their three letter symbols.
But, Amazon.
Amazon. What kind of a boom did they have in Bisbee? I don't know anything about Bisbee.
Copper mining. Yeah. Go on. If you go on Google Earth, there is a huge fucking pit in between downtown Bisbee proper and where we're at, which is about 3 miles from there, in Warren, which is the community just outside of the downtown area. And it was a mountain that they had started to drill into, and they were mining, copper ore for plenty of years. And then someone said, hey, there's a new way to do this. Just start digging down and pulling the earth out until you don't hit any more copper ore. And they did that and didn't stop for many years. Basically took out all the mine shafts and everything, and basically just took all the earth and moved it somewhere out, just displaced it around town, kind of like they do in the Shawshank Redemption, where he kind of jiggles it out of his pocket. Well, there are man-made Shawshank Redemption mounds all over.
The highest pitcher mounds in the world found in Bisbee.
It's how they enclosed towns, and then they dug a tunnel through it so you could get to the town. So there's little hamlets all over. So this pit is now, it's 1100 feet across. It's 900 feet down, and that's at street level. The mountain, you have to use your imagination. The mountain actually went up further. So the actual amount of earth that they removed was just massive.
So do they, like, is digging a pit better because you don't have to worry about the mountain, like, caving in on you?
Okay. Who's asking? The mine company or the miners?
Yeah. Well, you could get more miners.
Well, what happens is when you've got a mine situation, when you think of it in the old days with guys with pickaxes and sledges and all this shit, and they're dynamiting and digging like horizontally and then shafts down, and then they're moving through the mountain like that's very labor intensive and it's very dangerous, but everyone's employed. There were 45,000 people here during the boom. Well, when you start to get heavy machinery in there and you start digging, a lot of those guys get laid off. There's a huge history of what was going on out here.
What are those 7 and 8 year olds going to do, Greg?
It's not seven and 8 year olds. It was actually, I mean, John and I'll try and get this as correct as possible, but I mean, I don't think anyone really fact checks or looks for history lessons from here, but they would have people from all over the world would be here, and their expertise would come with them in working in the mines. So you had Mexican laborers who, by the way, were not allowed to go down in the mine for some reason. And then you had people from like Croatia or something that would come all, you know, halfway across the earth. And those guys would be like, they would be the tip of the spear. They'd be down there doing some of the fucking crazy shit. And then you had all these different other people working in the mine, and it was all, you were all separated in kind of little cliques. And
why wouldn't they let the Mexicans in there?
I don't know. It's part of the history. There's a CD, I think 60 hours of oral CD of people who have recollections or history ties to Bisbee back in the day. It's amazing. And we listen to it when we're on the road.
I mean, I have a theory. And you know what? I don't condone this, but I think it's because of the taco farts, you know, which is a stereotype.
Which would make it very flammable down there.
Yeah.
Yeah. They'd have to have the special canaries.
They probably saw it as the future. They go, we'll probably get more Mexicans. So what we'll do is we'll say they can't go down there. And then when the other guys leave, they'll be like, we want to go down. You go, okay, we'll let you.
So they were just making it seem like an exclusive job. until they wanted it.
I was sitting there down there going, we win.
There's so much great stuff down there, guys. Wish you could go.
Iron ore isn't like gold or blood diamonds. You can't oh, there's some iron ore. I'll put this ton in my pocket and I will yield 12% later. I mean, it had to be probably that they just had more experienced people and the Mexicans were like low on the totem pole, so to speak.
Yeah, I don't know. That's just the interesting fact. That's a weird one then. Allowed to go down there. You go, okay.
That's where you want to go.
When did the Bisbee boom end?
Mining stopped in 1970, maybe 75. But there's still tons of shit going on. I don't know what it is, but you know, as the years, like the mining, the techniques for mining, when it changed from mine shafts to open pit, they actually got better at reclaiming the ore. So they would actually go back to some of these big pitcher mounds, the Shawshank Redemption pitcher mounds, and they would pull that ore back and then reprocess it because they improved on the way of pulling out the copper and any other minerals they were going for.
Oh, that's actually pretty cool. Then you could do, you know.
Like yeah, then you find out they're asking, hey, you got any mounds on your property that we can we want to check it, you know? And it's like, well, what do you want to check it for? Well, you want to, you know, any kind of like contaminants, really? Like, I don't know, copper. Yeah, there's a lot of, I don't know. The mining companies, and we'll close on this because there's a lot going on.
This is what our audience wants, right?
The mining companies, they're in it for the long haul. They don't fucking care. And I mean, no one drinks water out here at the tap, although they say you can, but I mean, they basically use,
you can drink anything.
You can drink anything. But I mean, they will do whatever they want. And when it comes down to it, they love ghost towns because ghost towns means they can buy all the property that they don't have yet. So basically they keep the mine op. This is the biggest mining operation in the world that owns this out here. Something Freeman McCorin or something. But they basically, they're just sitting and waiting, and they would love for Bisbee to go out of business. But a mayor way back in the day figured out that if he attracted an artist community here and kind of a liberal mindset, that they could have their own kind of tourism.
And that's, you'll never find another person willing to work in the mine.
That's that too. I don't think you need anyone. All they do is they drive these big scrapers around in dump trucks.
I mean, they have robots.
Yeah, they have robots. Perfect.
Doesn't that create dust?
Oh yeah, there's tons of shit. I mean, it's just part of the landscape around here. And everywhere that they've dug up out of the mine, this is what creeps me out, is everywhere they've dug up out of that pit and then put that earth somewhere else, nothing's growing on those mounds. There's just barren mounds. I mean, you could see where an actual mountain was there, or if you're looking at the landscape, you can tell what was there originally and then where they started dumping shit. It's not like when you tear up an old driveway and then resod it, all of a sudden, you know, it looks different, but then, you know, the grass, it'll all mingle and then, it'll all look, you know, uniform. That's not what's happening out here. No way.
Well. I have so many more questions.
I know, John. I'd love
about mining.
Yeah,
I didn't know this is what we were going to do. I want to hear about Becker's trip. How it's going so far?
Oh, it is fantastic, actually. And yeah, it's been exactly what we always do. We've been running around playing poker. We watched the final of the World Series. Somebody made $8 million, and it was not the guy that was the chip leader for the entire game. And then that always tells you that, you know, anybody can win.
Anyone can win.
Anybody can win. I sent Becker this article. I didn't send it to you, Greg. I don't know if you saw it, but a woman in Oregon in a casino, was playing a slot machine and won an $8 million jackpot. And then the casino said, nope, the machine malfunctioned. Here's $80.
$80?
Yeah. They just told her that. Yeah. Just, you didn't win.
I mean, the first thing I would do is say, I'll see you in fucking court. I mean,
well, no, they agree to that. That it says on all the things, if it's deemed a malfunction and that's their call,
yeah,
then mm-hmm. it's, yeah, then you don't get paid.
But why even give her the $80 then? Like,
well, because they said what happened was it put too many zeros on it. It somehow had
a that's how you get from 80 to 8 million. You just keep adding zeros until you run out of zeros.
But they said they told her within like 15 minutes that, yeah, we're not paying yet. This is a glitch. But like, she's now going, I'm traumatized and this changed my, I had life changing money for 15 minutes and now I have to go back to my job.
Well, I think that's fair because I think most people, like, for the first, when you think you just won $8 million, you can be a real dick in 15 minutes and ruin your life.
Oh, yeah.
I think that might have been why they gave her $80. I could buy you blah, blah, blah.
That wouldn't even pay for the drinks I knocked over when I thought I won $80 million. Or $8 million, I'm sorry. See, I'm adding zeros.
Yeah. That's how it happens, Greg. It's easy.
That's it. Malfunctioned. But yeah, I thought it was one of those things where people don't realize the casinos pretty much, they do what they want. And how about DraftKings, huh?
Yeah, I just saw that. The you're talking about the daily fantasy sports bet. There's dual something.
FanDuel and DraftKings. I guess they both just got valued at over $1 billion each.
Yeah, because everyone's doing it. People you never think are doing it. Oh, you'll do it. I heard you can win. And you go, oh, wow, this doesn't sound like gambling at all.
And yeah, but it's like that school, ITT Tech. It's been on commercials that run during the day where people that don't have jobs see it. And you hear all this ITT Tech. I've heard that since the 70s. I don't know one person that has graduated from ITT Tech. And this FanDuel and everything.
They show you people on the commercials.
Well, I know they do.
Yeah, Greg.
But I don't.
He's the real his people.
Name is Jeff. He's a mechanic.
But
he works at Best Buy fixing things.
The FanDuel and the fucking other one, DraftKings, they give out millions of dollars, some outrageous number. But I don't know anyone who does that. And we have a lot of sports fans that show up here.
Well, you don't know anybody who wins.
No. But
that's what happens. See, Greg, when you're in an artist community, they probably don't go into a lot of online gambling.
They're shit. Artists are shitty at fantasy sports. There's an article that said, like, the top 10% of winners from FanDuel were employees at DraftKings, and the top 10% of winners at DraftKings worked at FanDuel.
Yeah.
So it's like the employees that have all the information and that are, like, writing these codes are winning on the other site.
And they said there's nothing wrong with that as long as they don't gamble on our site. And then they've got them gambling actually on their site. And I was like, I go, there's no regulation. You banned online poker for fucking no reason. And then all of a sudden now you're going, oh no, this is legal. Yeah. Cause picking a week, that's what they said. You go, well, people are putting in 200 different submissions and you're saying it's not, it's a skill. And they go, it's the lotto now.
Sounds like Keno to me.
My favorite thing is the ads are all like, you don't want to do the commitment of like joining a fantasy league. This is one time. Like it's easy. It takes no time at all. And then, like, in that same report, I think they said that, like, the people who are actually winning any money, like, small amounts of money, are the people that are putting in, like, hours and hours a day.
Yeah, like a part-time job.
Yeah.
Well, to be honest, let's not kid ourselves. They're doing it during their full-time job. So it's not like.
But, you know, what I will tell you is I'm at the sports book Jared had a good one because, you know, they banned it in Nevada first.
Of course.
Jared actually booked his picks for FanDuel or whichever one he's on. He booked it while flying right before the Nevada border on the Wi-Fi on the plane.
Mm-hmm.
Because once you get in Nevada, they will not let you make the bet.
Hmm. Oh, while you, you're in.
Right, but he goes, fuck, I didn't do it.
In New York, too. Are those the only two states, Nevada and New York?
Arizona, Washington. There's Iowa. Because I guess what the law is in some states is if it's 51% skill, then it wouldn't be considered gambling. I mean, if there's 51%
rule. Oh, fuck.
But the other states have, if randomly you could ever win, then no.
How do you measure the percentage of skill it takes to win something?
Well, I mean, I don't know. I mean.
Well, that's what the professionals are there for, John.
I guess that's for the courts to decide.
Yeah. It is interesting that I don't know about Iowa, but Arizona, Washington, Nevada, and New York all have gambling. They have
casino but that's gambling. What this is about.
Yeah.
They said, if you're going to do this, we'll tax it, but you're going to have to register, be licensed, have a state oversight committee. Then you can do your silly little fantasy game.
Doesn't sound fun anymore. Now it just sounds like those fucking horrible slot machines at the native casinos that are – they look like slot machines. You think it's a slot machine, but the metrics is all based on bingo. And if you read the small print that no one reads on the side or the bottom of the fucking slot machine, it tells you – that this is not a slot machine. It looks like a slot machine. You play it like a slot machine, but this every time you're hitting the lever or pulling the lever, or pushing the button, it's basically a game of bingo.
Yeah.
And that's how the Indian casinos are allowed to compete, because they can't have the same games to start with as like Atlantic City in Nevada, Las Vegas.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I never really thought fantasy sports seemed like fun, so my opinion hasn't changed.
Well, here's the deal. What I will say, and this is what I saw firsthand on Monday Night Football, because we're at the sports book here in the Flamingo, and we were busy playing Pai Gow while watching the game, and it was packed. Pai Gow. But everybody in the world had their phone out for the shittiest game of the week, because they had a player and they wanted them to fucking score or do whatever they're going to do. And so it's what it's done is it's made people follow sports from baseball on. They fucking hang on every goddamn player, because if they have them, they're like, oh, all I need is him to run 15 yards. And
a fucking waste of time.
Yeah, no, but I know.
You know the NFL is like the ones pushing all these things.
Sure.
100%.
Whatever happened to just like not knowing anything about sports and betting whoever you're with.
Just watching and eating and drinking with your friends, and then when the game's over, maybe talk about it, but mostly just go to the next game.
What happened to them? Just enjoying the game, getting carried out on somebody's shoulders, marrying the fucking prom queen, moving on, getting a job. Stop.
Good old American
don't hit
balance.
Girls in the face. What happened to that? The American dream. Now, you know what? That's a fantasy. That's my new thing. I'm going to do the American Dream Fantasy fucking league. And you're going to write down all the shit you thought you'd be doing right now, John.
And do you build a roster of like immigrant workers who come in, and you're like, oh,
yeah,
this guy just picked up an extra shift at McDonald's. He's going places.
Fuck yeah. Guess what? He's legal now. Boom. Minimum.
Whoa, we just got overtime. You accrue actual worked hours.
Fantasy American League. I love it. We're doing it.
I would play that game.
Yeah.
That seems like more fun. Things are on the line at that point. Like, I don't care if your wide receiver caught two touchdowns and it fucking changed your whole fantasy league. That doesn't matter to me. It's still just a bunch of people playing a game. But when it's people's lives, if somebody like somehow like picks up extra shifts or like gets their GED, That's a life-changing fantasy event.
Your guy got picked up in the Home Depot parking lot to lay floor. Mm-hmm. And then he got an extra side job of putting in a ceiling fan. Fuck, you're stoked.
Yeah. Did you hear about Luigi? Prostate cancer. No fucking way. I just picked him up.
You got to read the bio and you got to look in the genetics, dude.
Yeah, he got cancer. He's going down from three jobs to two jobs. Really kind of set him back.
So we got a big thing happening here this weekend called Side Pony.
What's and that?
It's a music festival.
I thought that was like your. It's that's a pony you don't want your main pony to know about.
side pony. It's a Side Pony Express. This is what their website says. Independent music from southwestern underground bands. So, but they have basically anywhere that has a stage or electricity or a light shining into a corner will have a band playing.
But not necessarily all three of those.
No, bands. Absolutely not. But the one thing that's cool is that the organizers, it's the 13th, 14th, and 15th in Bisbee, and they have sound set up at the major venues, and they'll have an engineer that's basically running it. Like, you know, getting you on and off stage really quick. And then, you know, but since it's a, you know, it's a it's kind of an artist community and stuff. There are like buskers and stuff. So there's lots of entertainment going on. And like I said, there are acts all over this little four main streets in these two little canyons here in Bisbee in the downtown area. So it's pretty kick-ass. And most of it's free.
Wow. How long does this go on for?
Just this weekend. Friday starts at 10 a.m. on Friday to 2 a.m. Friday and Saturday, and then Sundays 10 a.m. to 10 p.m.
And are you expecting an influx?
Oh yeah, there's already people starting last week. We had the mariachi festival that was 2 days.
Oh what?
Yeah, it was pretty kick-ass too. I mean, the weather is perfect out here. We're getting into when the snowbirds start coming in, and then there's tons of guest houses and not much Airbnb out here. There are a few, but there's lots of bed and breakfasts, and there's a couple of hotels. It's a quaint little place, this Bisbee.
Have you, speaking of mariachi, have you heard of Metalachi?
Yes.
I just heard of them, and they may be my new favorite mariachi band.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
There's a dude who comes to, I think he lives in New Mexico, but he visits here quite a bit. Mike Montoya, and his family is in a mariachi band, and he's a musician that comes down here. He does a lot of other projects and does solo stuff. And, yeah, he told me about Metalachi. I mean, they get respect.
I mean, they're great. Everyone should look them up on YouTube.
Oh, they'll probably be playing during this discussion.
That's what I was going to lie. I was wondering, are they coming to town? Are they still hanging around?
I didn't see that. I don't know if they've ever been here. I was looking at the lineup of the bands. I don't recognize a lot of these bands, but...
Well, mariachi bands are really hard because they all wear those glittery little outfits, and you're like, yeah, I love these guys. Are they the blue or the red ones? Check the lost and found. Who lost the hat?
Didn't you play on Cinco de Mayo that one year?
I love you guys. If it was you, I don't know.
Yeah.
So Side Pony Express, that's going on this weekend.
That's cool. How long have they been doing that?
At least 2 years, because I went last year.
Okay.
But I'm not sure. I'm kind of new. Oh, and the one thing I was going to tell you guys about last week, but I didn't, was Doug was going to announce his upcoming special he's recording here in Bisbee at the Royale.
Oh, cool.
I think it's about 150, capacity for about 150. And, the whole thing is being done by Doug and no production company. We just got guys coming in and filming. And, yeah, he's doing that. And he's also doing a small little show in the Funhouse here. They're building the stage now. That he's going to do just his Popov 30-minute bit on.
Very nice.
Yeah. Hmm. And that's in 2 weeks. So we got – Bisbee's happening, man.
No, I know. The way you sell it, I'm like going, I don't know why that place isn't packed. I don't know why mining didn't come back.
Well, yeah. Well, the show sold out in like an hour. We released it through an email through DougStandup.com that people have signed up. And within 11 minutes, something crashed on it. And then within an hour, all the tickets were sold.
Yeah.
Are you worried about scalpers?
I wish I would have bought a ticket because I'd be the first scalper.
Tucker Campbell, former AK comic, now living in Colorado.
Yeah.
Tried to hit me up for tickets. He's like, can you help me get these tickets? I was like, no, I can't. How could I? I cannot.
Well, I met
Stanhope once and he didn't like me at all. So
he reached out to me and I told him there are no tickets. There's just no one even in town is.
Did you tell him to get a job at the venue?
No, I just said, you know, why don't you come down here for the Friday show, which is going to be the small funhouse show and watch. I mean, that's worth it. Just come here for that. And then if a ticket becomes available, you'll be here. That's how you can do it. So.
He should have been down there for the mariachi.
You'd think, right? He's such a fan.
God.
I would just move there.
So, but he's,
that way you're not missing any of this.
He's
never miss anything again.
He's driving 13 hours from Colorado by himself.
Yeah.
So is he unemployed or something?
I think he worked at a beer garden. So that, I think that was a seasonal thing. He's a seasonal worker.
Yeah.
So he banked that.
Yeah. He made his nut over the summer and he's ready to travel.
Yeah. Yeah. That's great. Yeah. He'll fit in perfect down here.
He'll definitely, he will. He'll be on mushrooms. He'll be wandering around lost.
Oh, perfect. Yeah, we've got.
Tell him he went to the show. You loved it.
I don't have a segue for this. Do either of you have a Vitamix blender?
Yeah.
What do you think of it? Because I've been drinking a lot of smoothies, and I think the Vitamix is bullshit because I've been doing fine with my $7 thrift store blender.
Yeah, I guess it all depends on what you want to get out of it. Do you just want to make a milkshake or what?
What do you get out of the Vitamix?
Well, with the Vitamix, you can really pulverize. Like, so if you're going to use a lot of like leafy greens and stuff, it can get kind of stringy if you have a regular
wine corks.
Yeah, yeah. If you want to really chew up that wine cork or that hockey
that's
puck.
Like the whole. That's a couple years ago. That's how like they promoted the Vitamix was with that show, like Will It Blend, and they were blending like cell phones and hockey pucks and stuff.
Yeah, yeah. The hockey puck would just become dust.
At the time, I thought that was cool, but now I realize like I don't need that. I don't need it. I'm not trying to drink a hockey puck.
Well, my argument is this: your body's supposed to do some of this.
Yeah.
I mean, if you put it in the way it comes out, yeah, why bother?
Your body in fighting shape, Greg. You gotta let it like meet it halfway.
Well, I mean, it's too late now. You already bought the Vitamix, right?
No, I didn't buy it.
Oh, okay.
I'm rocking a Cuisinart. I'm sure it was like maybe $30 at Walmart. I got it for $7 at.
Yeah, there are a lot of off brands from the Vitamix. Vitamix is like, you know, $500.
Yeah, it's crazy.
But I got to tell you though,
that's one way to lose weight.
can't afford the food.
You can't afford to put anything in that blender now.
Yeah, but it looks good.
Just hockey pucks.
I did make soup. This thing fucking blends squash and carrots.
You don't have to blend soup.
Well, no.
But you also have a stove in your kitchen where you keep the Vitamix, right?
No, the Vitamix blends at such a high rate of speed, and you, there's a setting on it. Not the base model, but like a one or two up from the base model. And it's a soup model and you throw in like a little bit of liquid, your vegetables, some seasoning, and then you just set it and it goes from like a medium, whip to like just fucking supersonic. And it actually heats the soup. When it's done, the soup is cooked and you just pour it out of there into a bowl.
I feel like this is just a problem that like, it's a solution to a problem nobody ever had. Yeah. I don't think anybody ever said, fuck, I love this blender, but I wish it made soup. I wish it would make just soup.
Or it's just a byproduct of the technology. They didn't realize that they could save a little time. I don't think anyone was really upset with having to wait for squash soup.
maybe I'm just jealous because I don't have one. So I'm trying to shit on your Vitamix, and that's not fair.
Well, I don't have one. Doug's got, I think, two or three here.
Oh, fucking.
Hey, don't you do the mail order that stuff there?
But he, yeah, he'll never miss one. Yeah.
So you could be making a daiquiri and fuck up, and then you have hot daiquiri.
Yeah,
you got to be careful.
A hot daiquiri, that's like almost a slush drink. Boy, that sounds delicious right now, by the way.
A boiling hot daiquiri.
But I think you're right, John. I mean, the Vitamix, if you had something specific that you wanted to get the Vitamix for, then I'd say, yeah, it's probably indispensable if it's something that only the Vitamix can do. If you want to make some smoothies until you finally get sick of smoothies and then you want to sell your blender on eBay, then, yeah, get the $30 one at Target.
Yeah, I mean, I could buy a shitload of these $30 blenders.
Well, you could upgrade your fruit selection.
Yeah, you know, You don't have to buy that sale fruit that's all bruised up. You could go for the real.
But if you're going to blend it up.
It really doesn't matter at that point.
I like to look good.
When
I'm Instagramming every step of the process, they got to look good.
Have you ever tried to do like orange peel, make a zest?
Yeah. Didn't work.
Yeah, it didn't work.
Yeah,
I think last year when I tried to do 3 days of juicing, I quit once I put like chard or like some sort of greens that I had never had before, but I thought it would make like a good juice, and it like turned out to be like pepper spray.
Ooh, that would juice. Be. I think that's the chard.
That's when I had. Yeah. That's when I quit because I had no idea.
Yeah, I don't know what I'm doing here.
Or mustard green.
Yeah, that's why you go to Jamba Juice.
Yeah,
they have an ingredient list. That's why I don't like going to the Cold Stone Creamery or those places where they've got like all these different kinds of like combinations that you can do. And then I always walk away going like, I'm not a good ice cream chemist.
And you don't have anybody to blame at that point.
No,
you're the one who told them what to do.
No, I
take it back. Like, I don't like this. They'd be like, why'd you pick that?
I said more dragon fruit. Into my fucking vanilla chocolate cake fucking batter concoction.
With bubble gum.
Yeah, and then I find out I'm allergic to dragon fruit.
They're like, well, you should have consulted a doctor before you tried making ice cream.
No, if it said vanilla, I would have said, I'll take a medium. And that I would have fucking walked out happy. But now
I believe it's a you like it, love it, or gotta have it.
Yeah.
There's no medium.
Yeah, that's down here. There's tons of blended drinks, and there's nothing funnier than seeing a guy in a business suit walk around with one of those long, fucking duck shaped fucking drinks. Like, he's walking around with a 3 foot fucking sippy drink playing baccarat. I'm like, you look retarded.
Are you talking about the bone? That big. Just, it looks like I think what you said, John. A yard. It looks like a yard of alcohol.
Yeah,
so it's got a ball. There's
like ones that are shaped like guitars and like saxophones and like everything.
And you know what? Here's the one thing I've noticed watching these people is, like I said, first the guy in the business said, "I go, did somebody hand that to you and say hold this? I mean, I don't get it. You ordered that, but they have shapes now of animals.
In his head, he thinks he looks like Dean Martin, though.
I know, but I only assume is he goes, well, I'll give the kids this when I'm done with it. I don't know what the hell he's doing, but it's so ridiculous. And it never, like the guitar one, it's a big fat lady. He goes, she doesn't play guitar. I don't know how you ordered the guitar. It's like you and fucking ice cream, Greg.
Yeah.
You're ordering the wrong ones.
Totally.
But have you ever been to somebody's house where they like collect all of those like cups and all those like, collectible cups from like restaurants and casinos and fairs and stuff, and they offer you a glass of water and like a big like empty saxophone, like a giant saxophone,
a ceramic bathtub.
So yeah. That's the new thing down here is all the high-end places, even fucking, you know, we were over at the Bellagio or whatever, and their high-end fucking Cartier shops and all that shit, they've now got cut off Grey Goose glass.
Yeah.
They're the bottles. I'm like, this is ridiculous. And they're not even well done. I'm like, those are you're selling empties? How broke is Vegas is what I'm asking. I would expect this from Mike Tyson, not from you. If you like a Dooney Burke purse, we'll throw in a glass.
But if you try to buy one, they're not cheap. If you think the vodka is expensive, try buying the vodka bottle. That shit is crazy.
It's crazy. I don't get it.
I heard that Vegas doesn't even pay. Like the high end clubs, they don't even pay for liquor. That like Grey Goose and the high end liquors will bring in, you know, a truckload of liquor so that they serve it there. But they're getting $500 for bottle service for a bottle of fucking Sky.
I don't think that's true. Let's not forget, it's still a level of horrors down here that they're not giving you anything. But I'm sure they get a great deal. But at the same time, they're selling the bottles, Greg. I don't think they're getting them free.
I'm sure there is a deal though that is struck that like we will feature Grey Goose, and we get this fucking sweetheart price. There's gotta be. I mean, because then they would negotiate a better price from Sky later. Or they'd go, you know, Ciroc or whatever the fucking swill that people think is different.
Yeah, it's weird. You know, alcohol prices down here are off the charts. that's why I said the stage door is such a great fucking venue. But like in the casino itself, I mean, we'll get hit for $9 for a fucking can of beer. And you're like, are you serious?
Hey, John, did you get to the stage door when you visited Vegas that one time last year?
Almost. I almost made it. I almost made it. Nope, I did not go. But we...
Oh, that's right. You were vomiting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was so close. I was so close. I would hit up the liquor store over across the strip from like the Luxor.
Mm-hmm.
And that was kind of my place. We would stock up there. And it was reasonably priced. Like probably overpriced, but like compared, not insanely.
See, that's, so
we'd fill up the bathtub with ice.
Yeah, they love that when you do that.
Yeah.
The convenience store next to the stage door between Batista's and that, their prices are so ridiculously reasonable. It's unbelievable. It was an 18 pack for $11.
Well, I mean, the way you're going to get the best deals, though, Becker, and
I'm on the strip.
But if you get off of the strip, there's a place that we used to hit all the time when we were going to the desert party, because a couple of years we started in Vegas and then drove out, was Lee's Discount Liquor. I remember that because it was a huge like shopping market, supermarket of liquor. And that was a ways off the strip, but that's where all the locals are drinking. I mean, that's where people, you know, get off work, go to their apartment complex and go over to Lee's and, you can save money there. I know what you're talking about though. Those little places, that sell on the strip, but they'll have certain things that are on special, but you go try and get a good bottle of vodka or something there.
But you can also just go to like, there's like a Walgreens on the strip and they have like, you can get a can of like a 24 ounce can of beer for like $3.50. So there are options.
Wow. You were really living it up, dude.
Yeah, I was.
I can't believe you were nauseous most of the time.
I was saving up for my $30 blender. I wasn't going crazy. So as long as you stay away from the casino bars.
Dude, you can make a Bloody Mary with tomato soup. The homeless guy showed me.
You can drink anything.
Oh, the homeless have been very funny this time. They're all – we walked down one of the – over the Caesars Bridge because apparently you can't deny them to all line up on the Caesars Bridge. But apparently they made rules. They aren't allowed to be aggressive or panhandlers. But they were all eating fried chicken. We just had me walking by. Are they all eating fried chicken? I don't know.
So what was happening? Norm McDonald, you know, in town doing a little promo for the Colonel?
Yeah, I'm not aware of.
How did everyone have chicken?
How did they have chicken? I don't know. Seems that like it was the amazing part, but they were all different indigents, and you know they all had the sign. I'll be honest, I just need a beer.
Yeah,
but I went, you got any more chicken?
I'll trade you. I'll buy that piece of chicken off you.
I'll get you beer. But yeah, it was just funny. Just the idea. Because, you know, they probably don't have handy wipes is what I was thinking. Yeah. And so then they're going to wipe it on their clothes and now they're all greasy and you wonder why you can't find work.
Yeah, next time you grab that dollar from the guy at Walgreens in change.
Next time I suggest sushi.
Yeah, nothing goes better. I mean, it's really kind of a fucked deal because nothing goes better with a nice piece of chicken than a beer.
You know what my job was? My job was this time was I was trying to get one of the shirts from the guys that hand out the nudie cards on the street, which they've regulated a lot more than they used to be.
The guys who flip, they snap them.
Tap, tap, tap. Yeah. I wanted to buy one of the shirts from them. They will not sell one of those shirts.
Oh, the shirt that's advertising the company that they work for?
Like the one that – my favorite was the one that had orgasm spelled wrong.
Right. See, that was it. And I'm thinking I'll just take a picture and make my own.
That is genius though, because it makes you look at that person like more than once. Because you look at it and they're like, did they spell it wrong? And then you're looking again. Next step is you're like ordering hookers for your room.
Advertising works, dude.
Yeah.
If that was spelled right, you only would have looked at it once and not remembered.
Man.
Boy, these guys.
There are some real geniuses out there.
The best and the brightest on the streets.
Being wasted.
On the streets of Vegas.
Yeah, like I said, we spent a lot of time in late night in the casino, and I was running to go to the bathroom, and this hooker walked up. I mean, I assume she's a hooker. I hate judging people like that, but she's tried
but
to
she
solicit
said,
me.
But she said, you can fuck me for $20.
No, well, she tried to solicit me, but I go, I really have to go to the bathroom, so if I could just, you know, and she's like, that's cool. And I'm like, no,
no,
it's
no.
Not. No, I really have to go to the bathroom. Not on you, but yeah, I have to go. Yeah. And, but yeah, it was funny because, she said, "Hey, that's a great shirt." I was wearing one of my Hawaiian shirts. I go, "Thanks." And then you feel like you have to compliment them. And I'm like, "Nice earrings." I don't know. What am I going to say?
Becker tongue tied. That's odd.
Yeah. I had to go to the bathroom. That was really the Quiznard of the whole thing.
Just blocking the bathroom door.
Yeah.
Nice shirt.
That's okay, honey. Wherever you want.
Yeah. But yeah, like I said, it's been really busy. It's I don't know why it's so busy down here right now. I assume it's discount airfares, but as people are everywhere, and the cabs are gruff. They're very gruff. We had a guy there tonight. He goes, he didn't turn the meter on. Oh, that's what it was. Is we here picked us up to Tuscany because we'd gone to that strip club Dennis Zan owns.
Yeah,
and so we're at the Tuscany where you can go get a cab. We get the cab. And this chick gets out of another cab, and then our cabbie goes and tries to solicit the chick that got out. He goes, "You guys just wait here." And like, he leaves the car running. We go, "All right." And he chases her down and tries to do something. And he gets back in. He goes, "Fuck her." And we're like, "Yeah."
Wait, on your dime?
Like, we were all like, "Yeah, I can't believe she wouldn't go after a cabbie."
But he dropped the flag and then went running down a hooker?
Yeah. So we're sitting there watching the meter. I'm like, "Hey, what does she charge an hour? Because I know what you're charging." But yeah, it was pretty funny. He's just like, "You guys don't matter." I'm like, "What do you know? You left us with your car."
See, that wouldn't happen with an Uber.
No, it wouldn't.
You can't. Do they have an Uber in Vegas?
They do, but they can't be in the city. They can't work the strip or anything. So,
well, that
they worked out some kind of deal.
What's the point of that?
I guess I don't know.
The only place where people need an Uber.
You're allowed to bet on fantasy sports as long as it's not online.
Yeah.
I mean, it's Vegas rules. Good. I loved it. I went to a convenience store one time years ago, and I asked the lady, "Oh, and can I get some lotto tickets?" "We don't have lotto." And I go, "That's right. I forgot. Prostitution, gambling, but you forgot about the lotto." Yeah, that would ruin the city. They just don't have it.
Friday the 13th this week.
Is it?
Yeah, it is. John, I checked.
Wait, no, let me double check this.
Okay. Greg. Do you have a calendar?
Yeah, I got a calendar.
All right.
There we go. Yeah. Checks out. Story checks out.
Story checks out. Fact checked.
Yeah. Yeah, you going to do anything exciting for that, John?
I'm going to just go on a murdering spree or whatever, you know. I don't know. I guess I'll get in the spirit.
When's the burlesque show?
It actually starts on the 13th.
Ooh. Oh,
that would be a good segue.
Yeah. the Poles Burlesque Show, 13th and 14th and the 20th and 21st at Coots. It's going to be fun. Yeah.
I did see the Dance Hell trailer that you made.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that's very good.
Thanks. It was fun.
Does that have anything to do with the show that's coming up, or is this totally separate? Yeah.
That was we just made it for Halloween. It was supposed to be like a full blown short film, but I think we just tried to do too much in one day. So I was like, just making a trailer.
That was fine. Where did you get, I have to ask you this, where did you get the music for that?
It's like it was just a combination of a couple different like independent music producers who put their stuff out for free. And just say, like, if you're just making something for fun, feel free to use my music.
So where do you get – what's the site for that? Because I often run into that problem of looking for sound effects and music beds for commercials for the Stanhope podcast, that there's royalties attached to it. And you can use it as much as you want. You just pay one time. And I'm like, fuck, man, come on.
I got those from YouTube, actually. And I think one of the songs came from the Free Music Archive. Have you ever been to the Free Music Archive?
Oh, yeah, yeah. A lot of old scratchy 78 or like wax cylinders and stuff.
It's tough because you're trying to find like a certain thing, and you gotta go through like an hour and a half of shitty listening to like the first 10 seconds of a lot of shitty stuff to find that one golden track.
But then you do, you know, one thing that I found that was really interesting, and I'll put a link up to it because I thought they were really fucking great. This group got together and they recreated the theme to Little Rascals. They covered it, And they played it to a T. It fucking sounds so great. And then they did like old Oliver Laurel and Hardy stuff. They just got these old musical numbers that you would recognize. It's like someone covering like the Benny Hill theme. It just makes you smile.
Sacks.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Or doing Cheers.
You can do, yeah. I mean,
no one's done a good remake of that. Somebody's going to do it.
Everyone likes music that they're familiar with, and they like it when it's something they like, you know?
Did you see where they matched up the Friends theme with the Walking Dead intro?
No. Where's that?
It matches exact.
What, you start what you started with the Friends theme music playing? You started at the same time that Walking Dead?
This yeah, and like it's just the intro
Dark to Side of the Rainbow.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it matches up perfect.
People do that stuff for you now. You don't have to start it separately. I remember doing that in high school, doing the Dark Side of the Moon, Wizard of Oz, like start them both at the same time.
Yeah.
I'm so glad we live in an age where somebody else just does that and puts it on YouTube.
So you don't have to go borrow someone else's record player?
Yeah. It was so stressful because you're like, did I get it? Is it working? I think it's working. I don't know.
It's like the first time.
Am I too high to tell if it's working? What is happening?
It's like the first time you smoke pot, but your friend actually just fucking sold you oregano, and you're like, "Is it working? I think I'm high.
My throat really burns.
I totally feel something.
Well, see, that's where we take advantage. Like the YouTube, we just take it for granted now. But like, I looked up. It was one of those links. It started. It was hallucinogenic short films for when you're like tripping on mushrooms or something. And I went, oh, and there's like 90 of them.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden you're watching them. Some are amazing.
Oh, it's just like a video that everything melts.
Neon colors, yeah, and it just starts blending around. And I'm like, oh, these are great. And some are amazing. And then the other ones are bad. But by the time you find out they're bad, you're watching it. It's like all of a sudden a cow's vagina opens up and you're like, what the fuck? I go, I would not want to be tripping and see this. All of a sudden it's a little guy going, help me. Yeah.
You used to have to just stare at a poster under a black light.
Yeah. Or,
yeah. Until you fell asleep.
If you wanted to see like films like that, you'd have to go. You'd have to go to a midnight film like festival thing and be high around people, which is the worst. So this is truly the best time to be alive.
It's really. I
agree.
The robots are playing tennis for us. Basically, we don't have to do anything.
Hey, whatever happened with the fast food workers all walking out? Did they do that?
Yeah, they. I think it was Monday. Yeah, they did it on Monday.
All of them?
Well, they just organized walkouts throughout the country, and it was basically them picketing and insisting on $15 an hour. You know, by 2020. I mean, it's not like tomorrow.
Wait, that was Monday?
Yeah.
I bet that's where they got all the fried chicken.
Who made it for him?
Fucking KFC probably went, nobody's working. Go give it to homeless.
Well, no, yeah, they probably had a bunch of it, and they said, well, you know, we'll just use some grassroots street level advertising.
Yeah. We can either be in the news because our employees hate us, or because we gave homeless people all of our chicken.
I didn't realize that. I go, where did they get that chicken? It's still, see, I come to Vegas, all this stuff going on. I met Donnie Marie. I'm like, no big deal to me. They were in the elevator with me. They look a lot older, but they're still in good shape.
Youngish.
Are they a couple?
They're a brother and sister, sir.
I know that, but are they a couple?
They perform together. One's a little bit country. The other is a rock and roll.
A little bit country, a little bit rock and roll. Yeah.
But they look great. They were like running through the lobby and then we got an elevator and I said, wait,
are they, do they have a show like a Branson show in Vegas?
They have one at the Flamingo.
So, but is it just them, or is he? He was doing the Technicolor Dreamcoat for a while.
Yeah, but no, he's back.
So it's just it's like them doing a variety thing.
I think Greg Brady fills in when he's not doing it. But yeah, it's so funny because every time he's there, they always try to cop us out. And this time it was they used to do Donnie Marie. You guys want to go see Donnie Marie? We'll give you. Yeah, we're like no. This time they literally asked all of my good poker friends, we'll hook you up. You guys want to go to Britney Spears?
Britney Spears?
They're looking at the concierge guy. They're like, do we look like we go to Britney Spears? I mean, first,
Well, John would.
Yeah, I would totally go to Britney Spears. That'd be great.
See, John, you missed out.
You missed out, John.
But yeah. So I heard it snowed in Anchorage too. How'd that turn out?
You know, everyone freaking flipping their cars off the road.
That was about weird.
About as you would have expected to go. But there's not that much snow. It snowed fairly hard, I think, on Sunday night, and it snowed a little bit yesterday, but I don't know. It's like winter. It's nothing special.
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah. Officially, it is winter, right? Or is it fall? Mm-hmm. It's not really winter yet, right?
It's no. When does winter start?
I feel like Yahoo News would have informed me if there was a change in the weather or the seasons.
Yeah, I just felt like I flew out Sunday morning and then it turned to shit and I was like, thank God. I'm down here where it's safe.
Safe and windy.
But you know, there's still plenty of light, so it's not that bad yet. I have about another like 3 weeks before I'm totally sick of this.
Do you have plans to go somewhere, John?
In March. Because Stephanie is crazy busy with their burlesque show, and then they have their big like end of season show in February, so mm-hmm. She can't leave. So I mean, I could ditch her, but I might. But we're definitely going somewhere like the first week of March.
First week of March,
possibly Hawaii, because I've never been to Hawaii.
Yeah, try Hawaii. I mean, and you can. I think you can fly directly into Maui. You don't even have to go to Honolulu. Mm.
Is that where is Maui better than Honolulu?
Maui's a different island.
Yeah, but is it better?
Well, I don't, depends on what you're going for. If you want to hang out on Waikiki Beach, Honolulu is a bigger town than Lahaina, which is kind of that's on Maui.
I guess I'm just looking for drinks on a beach. So. I don't know what I'm looking. I guess I have to evaluate my goals.
The best way to go is to try and find someone that is renting their condo and then just stay in the condo. So you don't have to stay in a hotel.
And bring your own food.
And you can cook your own meals and you can, you have a full kitchen. Sometimes they'll have a pool so that you can actually be by the pool. And if you wanted to go to the beach, you'd go to the beach.
All right. That is what I want. I don't know how to figure that out. If we have any listeners who are going to be out of town and their Hawaii villa is open.
Yeah. Put it out there, John. Put it out there.
I would be happy to house it for you in March. Let me know.
And say you might bring a Vitamixer.
I probably won't bring a Vitamixer because it's pretty expensive. I don't want TSA to touch it. But, I'm not even picky about the island. If you live on Honolulu, I know Greg was just shitting on Honolulu, but. Yeah.
Well, I used to live on Honolulu.
During is that the one where is that the one where Dog the Bounty Hunter works?
I think yeah. He was in Honolulu because I remember seeing some of the unsavory areas. He was on Oahu. That's the island that Honolulu is the city. But you don't want to go to some of the islands. Like, I think Molokai, isn't that the one with the leprosy island?
Yeah, go to that one.
Go to that one, that's John.
That's where I want to go to.
Plenty of places to stay. Seems that they've always got vacancies. I think you'll have a good time.
Well, this has been another episode of Near the Wild. I'm Matt Becker, sitting in a large suite overlooking the Strip in Las Vegas, Nevada.
I'm John Norris in Anchorage, Alaska, staring at the snowy mountains.
And I'm Greg Shaley in Bisbee, Arizona,
looking at dead mounds of dirt.
You've been listening to the Near the Wild podcast with Matt Becker and John Norris, recorded in Anchorage, Alaska on Matt Becker's backyard bus, engineered by me, Greg Shaley.
It's weird. It's all green right where I can see out here. But if I look just past where the casinos are, it looks like Bisbee.